Hare Krishna. So today I'll speak about the mind based on a story from the fourth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. How many of you have heard the story of Puranjana? Anyone? Okay, thank you. The Srimad Bhagavatam has different kinds of stories. Stories in the sense that there are some stories which are about things happening on the earth. There are some things, stories which are happening at another level of reality. And there are some stories which are non-literal. Hare Krishna. Thank you. Hare Krishna. So some stories are non-literal, they are metaphorical. That means stories don't literally happen, but they are used to illustrate some things. So this story falls in that category. Now, of course, from every story, we can derive some non-literal meaning also. Okay, this symbol means this, this means that. But here, it's primarily symbolic. So we will look at the story in two parts. We'll look at the story itself and we'll look at the symbolism from the story. And we'll see how that can teach us something practical about how our mind works and how we can make it work for us instead of against us. The story starts with a king, Puranjana, who is traveling around hunting, and he comes to a magnificent palace, and there's a beautiful princess in that palace, and there are many servants over there. And he's surprised, oh, this is such a beautiful, he says, beautiful palace. He says, where did this come from? He says, where did you come from? Who are all these people? What are you all doing here? So when this question is asked, naturally, whenever we see anything orderly, generally our attention is attracted either by something which is very orderly or something which is very disorderly. If we come to a house and we see everything is spick and span, neat and tidy, oh, who is maintaining this house? Very well done. And if we see a house, everything is disorderly, that also catches attention. Generally for us, the world offers so many stimuli that we can't possibly take in all of them. So we take in those stimuli which are out of the ordinary, primarily in terms of something that matters to us. So there may be things which are out of ordinary also, but say if that out of ordinary especially matters to us, say if we come to a library and we want to search for a book, and everything in the library is very well ordered, you say, very good, now I can search for the book easily. If in that same library, maybe chairs might be disorderly, but if you are not planning to sit on that chair, we may not notice it that much. So basically, when we look at the world, we look at the world not in terms of what all exists, but what all matters to us. So basically, our vision of the world is always purposeful. Okay, what do I want? What will get in my way? And what will get me along my way? Say for example, if you come here for this program, now if you have some special gardening or botanical interest, then you might want to notice, okay, which specific plants are over here, how long each needs to take care of, what kind of flowers are, what kind of flowers and fruit do they give. But if you don't have botanical interest, then your primarily interest will be, is there a good place for me to sit, isn't it? So, okay, if you want to sit here, is it a comfortable place, is it too warm, is it too cold, I need a chair, is there a chair? So, now in this area itself, we can study a lot of things if you want to. So, but our knowledge is limited by our purpose. Or you could say, if not necessarily limited, focused, both ways. So basically, based on our because the world is so complex, so we look at what we want and then what will get us along the way? So if you come here to hear this class, then you would like a comfortable position. What will get along the way? Now if you know, say somebody, when they hear the, when they are hearing the class, they often get distracted, they look at, they say return answer message on the phone, they pick up the phone and answer calls, then you may want to sit away from them. So what gets us? What comes in our way? So here, when this king, the king's name is Puranjana. So Pura means city, Anjana means enjoy. So he's a person who wants to enjoy a city. So the name itself indicates what his purpose is. And that's why when he asks them, where did you come from? Where did the city come from? What are you doing here? So his questions are two parts. One is, what is the origin and all that? The second is, but what all are you doing here? So she, the princess, who later becomes his queen, she answers, actually, I don't know where I came from. I don't know who is my origin. I don't even know where this palace came from. But I just know that it exists. And I can see that you have a desire to enjoy. So we also are here. And let us both of us enjoy. We all here are to enjoy. And let us start enjoying. And as soon as he answers this, then we are all here to enjoy. Puranjan stops asking questions about origin. Where did you come from? What are you here for? And then he asks a little bit more. Okay, he says that we have this big snake over here. And this snake is my protector. And under the snake, we are all safe. So here, what is happening? The question is asked and he says, yeah, we are all here for your enjoyment. So similarly for us, basically in this metaphor, in the story, symbolically speaking, the city represents the body. The princess, the queen, she represents the mind. Now basically the subtle body, the mind, intelligence, all of it combined together. And Puranjan is the soul. So his questioning her, where did you come from? Where did all this come from? It is like the soul asking the material mind or the material intelligence. Here we'll use all of it as composite one thing. The soul asking I use the word mind to refer to the whole subtle body. We'll talk about little subtleties later. But so the soul asks the mind, where did this world come from? Where did everything come from? So I wrote a book on reincarnation. Maybe I have a few copies here. So there, while I was studying the book, I found that the Science magazine on its 125th anniversary, it published a special edition that about 125 questions that science does not have answers to. So the second question was, where did consciousness come from? Normally, the second question was, immediately the question comes in our mind, what was the first question, isn't it? The second unanswered question is with science is, where did consciousness come from? And the first unanswered question is, where did the universe come from? So, now science itself focuses on studying, okay, how do things work inside this universe? Mm-hmm. When Newton saw the fruit falling, and he said, oh, how did this fruit fall? He came up with the idea of gravity. But he is not asking the question, where did this fruit originally come from? Where did this tree come from? Where did gravity come from? So when we look at science, when we study with scientific worldview, we focus on certain questions. And those questions are primarily operational questions, functional questions. If you see questions about origins, they are largely beyond science. Although there is, sometimes science tries to answer those questions. But there's a scientist who wrote, how everything came from nothing. He said, I explained that. But if you look at his book, ultimately what is he doing? He is actually redefining nothing so that it is something. And then from that something, how everything has come, he's explaining. He's nothing. is, what he says is nothing. It requires 11 pages of complex quantum physics to describe. So that certainly is not nothing, isn't it? So he says, this is nothing italicized. It's italics nothing. So basically what happens, the point I'm making over here is that just as this princess does not answer Puranjan's questions, similarly the material mind, the material intelligence does not have any satisfactory answers for life's fundamental questions. Where did I come from? What is the purpose of life? But when she says, actually I can see you have a desire to enjoy, let's start enjoying. And when she offers that proposition, he forgets everything else. So let's start enjoying. It's like, say, at a simpler level, we could say, we come to some unknown place. Maybe we are going trekking and we see a big palace over, big house somewhere. And then while we are trekking, we are tired and we come into the house and we see a nice big TV over there. Now we may ask, where did this TV come from? But then if you press a button over there and the TV starts and a nice good movie is going on, sports is going on, you may just get caught in watching that, not worrying where this has come from. So similarly, what happens is, Puranjan forgets. He doesn't ask any questions, where does everything come from? Where did everything come, all this come from? And then, after that, is very interesting. As they start living together, it is described that when this queen got up, Puranjan got up. When she started walking, he started walking. When she sat down, he sat down. Whatever she did, he did. Now, at one level, we could say this is simply that he has become so attached to her. But at a deeper level, what it means is that the soul completely identifies with the mind. And the soul starts thinking just the way the mind thinks, and the soul doesn't think of or do anything else. That means the mind proposes, let's eat, oh yes, let's eat, let me sleep, I want to sleep, let me do this, let's do that. So now there are times, sometimes when we talk with people and say that maybe chanting mantras or practicing bhakti can control your mind. See, but I don't need to control my mind is already in control. Yes, your mind is in control of you. Not that you are in control of your mind. The mind is in control of you. See, basically, tension occurs. We may say, if somebody is in a horse and they are going wherever the horse is going, then there will be no tension over there. Isn't it? There will be no tension because they are not trying to resist it. It is only when the horse wants to go in a particular way and they don't want to go in that way, then they try to fight, then they may realize how strong the horse is. So for most of us, now we may say, okay, I've controlled my mind. But actually, it is not that we have controlled the mind has controlled us. Sometimes people say that, they make a resolution, okay, you know, maybe I am not going to do this, something which they decide. Sometimes they decide, maybe for this next 1 week, I am going to go on a digital detox. No more social media. And the next day, they are again surfing social media. This is what happened. I changed my mind. Well, did you change your mind or did your mind change you? So what has happened over here is that just as he got very attached to her and he didn't do anything apart from her, apart from what she was doing, similarly, we get caught in the spell of the mind. Now we may say, no, actually, I'm not caught in the spell of my mind. I do what I want to do. But basically, the mind, freedom is most effectively taken away by giving the illusion of freedom. What do I mean by that? That suppose there is a naive car seller, maybe an inexperienced. So they will make the whole pitch and they say, so sir, so ma'am, would you like this car? And somebody is a very experienced car seller. He will say, sir, what will he say?
This car is for you.
This car is for you, yeah, something better. We are talking about the illusion of freedom. So, sir, so would you like your car with the red seat or the green seat or the blue seat? Now, what is he doing over here? Well, I didn't say I want the car. He's presuming you want the car. So what is he doing is, there's apparently an illusion of freedom. But the freedom is within a particular domain. You have to buy the car, which car do you want to buy? So similarly, when our mind controls us, it does not take away all our freedom. It gives us the illusion of freedom, but the illusion of freedom is in a particular domain. That means, okay, do you want to eat this or this or this? Okay, but do I really need to eat right now? No. So the mind gives us pseudo freedom. And so we don't really think we are controlled. And this pseudo freedom is given through the modes. The three modes of material nature, sattva, rajas, tamas. They often create various desires within us. Oh, I want to eat this, I want to watch this, I want to go here, I want to do that, I want to sleep. Now when we have all these desires, we may choose one among those. We think we are choosing. But quite often, the mind is giving us a pseudo freedom and then it is controlling us. So based on this metaphor, if we consider what is the mind? So here what is happening? Now it's interesting, before I explain what is the mind. There's also one twist in the story, that while Puranjana is living with his wife and exactly doing whatever she is doing, at one point he suddenly leaves her and goes to the forest for hunting. And he goes for quite some time, and when he comes back, she's wild with him. She's furious. And then he has to go to great trouble to pacify her. So what this means is that sometimes if we reject the mind and do something else, we may think, oh, I'm the boss, but after that the mind just goes wild. Now sometimes you may have noticed that if you try to not do something, if you try to control the senses, control the mind, sometimes the mind starts becoming stronger than before. And it opposes, it rebels. How dare you defy me? And that way, the mind completely dominates us. So when we try to break free from the mind, after that, it comes and dominates us much stronger. And in the same way, now the king has to go to greater trouble to pacify her and satisfy her, because he has gone away from her temporarily. So here, if we want to understand this in terms of a metaphor, now we could say that it's like a computer. The software is what helps us interface with the hardware. So it's interesting in this metaphor what is said, although he is the king, he doesn't command any of the servants over there. This queen, she has primarily 10 servants, and all of them have many wives. So what do these 10 servants represent? 10 senses. And there are many wives, what does it represent? Yeah, many desires. When the desires, the objects come. The desires associated with the sense objects. So what is happening in this case? Even the soul wants to enjoy something, the soul cannot enjoy anything directly. It is always through the mind. It is through the mind. Everything that we experience is through the mind. Now, while this is going on, at this point, he is living like this and he thinks he is happy. But something else is happening. Now, there is one more person who is called the Avigyat Sakha. Avigyat Sakha means the unknown friend. So with Puranjan, there is this unknown friend, Avigyat Sakha, but this friend tries to catch the attention of the king. But the king pays no attention to him. The king keeps neglecting him, and then finally, whenever there is a kingdom, what happens? There are people who want to plunder the kingdom. There are attackers. Normally, if somebody wants to attack, they usually won't attack a a place which is very poor and which is having no wealth, unless of course they have enmity against those living over there, then they attack to destroy them. But normally if somebody attacks, they want to plunder the place that is wealthy. So this is the kingdom, and then there is an attacker. His name is Chandavega. Chandavega refers to the speed with which time comes and attacks. In the Bhagavatam, an example is given that time moves all of us just as the wind moves the clouds. This is a very interesting example. When the wind moves the clouds, because what happens that the wind is invisible. Similarly, time is invisible. But when the wind starts moving the clouds have no power to fight against the wind. The wind comes and the cloud may appear very big, but when the wind comes, the clouds are moved. So the mover is invisible. Now, to some extent, you could say the movement is also imperceptible. That means if I am constantly looking at a cloud, I don't really see the cloud moving unless it's moving very fast. But if I look now and if I look after 5 minutes, oh, that cloud over here, it's come here. So like that, time is moving all of us. Time is moving all of us, but we don't notice the movement of the time. It's imperceptible. See, we are all conscious of time in terms of minutes and hours because we use that as a working reference. But often we are not so conscious of time in terms of months and years. Time is passing and I am growing older. So, now when Chandavega attacks initially, the snake fights with him and the king doesn't even notice. See, normally there is always aggression going on. Now, even now, there might be some people who might be wanting to rob or steal or launch terror attacks. But there are security agencies which are protecting. And as long as the attackers don't penetrate too far inside, the general people don't even come to know that there is a danger. But if the terrorists or somebody penetrates in, then the government has to give alert, oh, terrorists are over here, stay in your home or go do this, don't do this. So like that, when Chandavega is attacking initially, nobody, the king, Puranjan, doesn't even notice it. Because the king, because he thinks that the snake is fighting. It's not clear? Is it better now? Okay, sorry. Better? Okay. Thank you for telling me. I didn't realize it. Okay, so actually, it's just moving away from me. Okay. Is this better? That's okay. Better? Thank you. So now, as this Chandavega attacks, then what happens? Slowly, the attacker starts gaining the upper hand. So, you know, when we are young and we are healthy, you know, we don't even notice that I am growing old. Prabhupada in a Hindi lecture says that koi buddha nahi hona chahta hai, par prakriti sabko chupcha buddha bana deti hai. Nobody wants to grow old, but material nature silently, helplessly makes everyone old. So then gradually, as Chandavega starts attacking more and more and the serpent is not able to defend, then the king starts noticing, hey, what's happening to my fortress? This is falling, this is not working, what is going on? So, we normally take our body quite for granted. For example, we eat food and then we get energy. And normally just take it for granted, I eat the food and get the energy. But in between there is a complex process of digestion. And the only time we think about our digestion is when it doesn't work. We normally take it for granted, but when it doesn't work, oh, what's going on? So like that, actually, sometimes we get irritated, we feel resentful when things don't work in our life. But so many things can go wrong at any time, and actually when things work, it is amazing. Not that when things don't work, it's frustrating. It requires a complex level of organization at an individual and social level for things to work properly. So anyway, when these things start collapsing, Puranjan starts becoming helpless. Now Puranjan, although he's supposed to be a king, and earlier it is said he has gone for hunting. But against this Chandavag, he's a king, but he has no weapons. He just doesn't know how the attack is coming and how to fight it. So like that, as time creeps upon us, time starts making us older. See, in any war, we have to fight. If the enemy is with weapons and we don't have any weapons, how do you fight? Just we become helpless. Somebody's with a gun and we don't have anything. What can you do at that time? So he's helpless. And then the serpent fights. And finally the serpent is defeated. And the serpent is defeated. The invader, Chandavag, pounces on this king and drags him and carries him away. So this Puranjan is in the city trying to enjoy. But suddenly, he is dragged out. So like that, for all of us, we as souls live in the body. But suddenly, time comes and drags us out. Sometimes it comes suddenly. Sometimes it may come slowly, gradually. But it comes. So here, basically, now there's also a further story of what happens to Puranjan in the next life. We'll see if we get time to go to that part. But let's focus on here right now, on our point of the mind. And how, as I said, how it works and how we can make it work for us. So basically, the mind offers us propositions. It's like this queen, she had these servants and they had many wives. So now, when the king wanted to enjoy, they were all there, whatever he wanted, they were providing. But now when we have, say, a big menu, so we may either get caught in seeing what all is there in the menu so that we can choose, or we might notice what is not in the menu. I'm not talking about menu in terms of, say, what is served on the like a buffet system, but in a hotel menu in the card, what all is not there. But in this case, what happens? We don't even think what is not there in the menu. That means the material nature offers us so many allurements, and especially as science and technology are advancing, what is happening? We have so many options for material enjoyment that we don't think of any enjoyment beyond the material. And thus, we stay in illusion. And in this, the Bhagavatam describes that the mind, when it describes how things originate in the third canto, the fundamental principles of material nature, it says that the mind comes from the mode of goodness. And it says that the intelligence comes from the mode of passion. Which can seem a little strange. Normally we associate the intelligence with goodness. But the point here is, it is not talking about intelligence alone, it is talking about material intelligence. And this differentiation we see in the Bhagavad-Gita also, that Krishna uses the word intelligence in two senses. In 340 and 41 in the Bhagavad-Gita, that whole section is talking about kama. Kama is self-destructive desire. How it attacks us and how we can control it. And initially Krishna says that actually kama has occupied your intelligence also. Indriyani mano buddhir asyadishtana muchyate etair vimohayatesha jnanamavritya dehinam. This is the intelligence is also occupied by kama, by self-destructive desire. And then after saying this in 340, then 343, Krishna says that evam buddhe param buddhva samsthabhyatmanam atmana jahi shatrum mahabaho kamarupam durasadam. With your intelligence, understand your transcendence and situate yourself in your transcendence, situate yourself spiritually, and therefore you overcome self-destructive desire, overcome calm. Now this is interesting. First Krishna says that your intelligence is overcome by calm. But then he says, use your intelligence to overcome calm. So what is going on over here? Yes, there's material intelligence and there is spiritual intelligence. Now, what do we mean by, are there like, in the intelligence department, there are two departments, you know, intelligence, there is material, there is spiritual. No, see, intelligence basically means that the whole intelligence or the subtle body is subtle. That's like a tautology. But the point is that subtle body is different from the physical body. With respect to physical elements, we can differentiate them based on their location. You can specify, okay, this is the earth, inside this glass there is water, there is air over here, then maybe there is fire somewhere. So we can localize them, specify them. But if we consider, say, the mind, intelligence and ego in terms of a computer metaphor, I said they are like the software. In a software, you might have the operating system, you might have the pre-installed programs or apps that come, say, in your phone, and then there are user-installed apps. Now each of them, you could say, function differently. The OS functions in a particular way. There are pre-installed apps which are fundamental, and there are user-installed apps which function in particular ways. But from the point of view of their structure or their constitution, all of them are just codes. Now, if you look at what is present in the digital data, it is just 0 1 0 1 0 1 combinations. Is codes. So the difference between, say, the operating system and a software and an application there's no structural difference. There's no constitutional difference. There is applicational difference. The way the OS functions is different from the way the operating system functions, the way different from the way some apps function. Now similarly, between the mind, intelligence and ego, there is no structural difference. Like the earth and water, they're structurally different. But between the mind, intelligence and ego, the primary difference is in terms of functionality. So what is the reason we are analyzing? I don't want to go too much into technicality. And if this part seems a little technical, you can just overlook it. We have a practical point over here. That why is it said that the mind comes from goodness and the intelligence from passion? So this differentiation between material and spiritual intelligence indicates more functionally what is that intelligence being used for. Say for example, now between in India, Kashmir is like a disputed territory. And so the Indian government has decided to completely integrate Kashmir into India. And now it's not that all of Kashmir is hostile to all of India. It is, say, Kashmir is divided into Ladakh is one area and then Jammu and Kashmir is another area. So the idea is that Ladakh is not that much hostile to India. So we can manage it in a different way and Jammu and Kashmir can manage in a different way. So we may need more force over there. We can have less, more harmony over here like that. So we could say similarly within our intelligence, there is a part that is spiritually inclined. That might be very, very small. And within our intelligence, there is a part which is very materialistically inclined. And that might be large. So when Krishna is saying, first your intelligence is overcome by calm, by self-destructive desire. And then he says, use your intelligence to overcome that desire. What he means is that don't treat the intelligence only as one monolithic unit. That especially if we hear from Guru Sadhu Shastra, our intelligence becomes spiritualized. And then we can use the spiritual intelligence to subdue the material intelligence. So now, if we consider by default, most people's intelligence is material intelligence. That's what we said earlier. When Puranjan asked questions to this queen, she had no answers. So the material intelligence has no answers to life's fundamental questions. So for functional purposes, we can say the intelligence is mostly material. So then what does the material intelligence do? The material intelligence actually comes up with newer and newer ideas for enjoyment. And if you see the mind's function is, mind has two functions. Does anyone know?
Rejecting.
Yeah, accepting, rejecting. What are Sankalpa, vikalpa, yes. So the mind has these two functions. I accept it, I reject it. Now when you accept and reject, somebody has to offer something for which you can accept and reject, isn't it? If nobody is offering, then what are you going to accept and reject? I don't accept this food, if I say. Well, there's no food here, what are you not going to accept, isn't it? So actually, it is the world which offers, but it is the world, the intelligence. Yes, maybe you can try this, maybe you can try that, maybe you can try that. So basically, goodness, it maintains things. Passion creates things. So the mind basically maintains us its material existence. Like I said earlier, the mind gives us the illusion of freedom. Illusion of freedom means choose this, this, this. But all the options that the mind offers are materialistic only. So in that sense, the mind maintains our material existence. And goodness is associated with maintenance. So in that sense, the mind is said to have emerged from goodness. Because goodness maintains and the mind keeps us in material existence. However, the material intelligence, like the passion creates, so the material intelligence expands. It creates new plans, new schemes. Let's try to enjoy this. Let's try to enjoy that. Let's try to enjoy this. Let's create this facility for enjoyment. And that's why although science and technology, they involve a lot of intelligence. But most of this intelligence is actually material intelligence. Because the greatest fuel for scientific progress is primarily the consumer industry and the defense industry. So the consumer industry is primarily about, you could say, about eating, sleeping, mating. The defense industry is about defending. So the four animal functions that are there, ahara, nidra, bhaya, maithun, eating, sleeping, mating, defending, they are the primary propellers of technological progress. So, much of the internet development, all this broadband technology, that has been fueled by people's desire to watch high streaming videos, movies, and all that stuff like that. So, it's entertainment. And what are videos, movies basically? They are basically showing people eating, sleeping, mating, and defending, isn't it? So, the material intelligence expands the creation. So that's why material intelligence expands the options for material enjoyment. It creates new ideas. So, and the mode of passion is associated with creation. So that's why it said the intelligence comes from the mode of passion. Now in this case, when the mind is working in this way, sankalpa vikalpa, the intelligence offers, maybe let's eat this, let's go to this place, let's go to that place. Oh, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no. Through all this that is going on, basically the soul stays obsessed. Soul stays obsessed and soul just doesn't think of anything beyond this. So now, how does one come out of this? Now, it's described in this, in a sense, Puranjan in that life is so infatuated that Puranjan doesn't have any hope. So if somebody is very materially infatuated, then what happens? Then they just can't. Bhogaishwari pasaktanam taya aparita chetasam vyavasayatmika buddhi samadhau na vidhiyate. One devotee yesterday, he had gone for book distribution and he said that he was telling somebody, you know, we should practice spiritual life. And that person said, he first said, I offered the Bhagavad-Gita. He said, I have read the Bhagavad-Gita already. Oh, really? Then we should practice spiritual life, he said, I am a soul, I am eternal. I have so many future lives to practice spiritual life. So now, this is like taking the philosophy and just distorting it. So this devotee said, then I told him, this is what you said in your previous life also. So, somebody can use the philosophy, say actually, what is the urgency? The soul is eternal and Krishna is also eternally available. Whenever you want, you can turn to him. But the problem with that is that I might be thinking like this because I am enjoying right now. But how long am I going to enjoy? The enjoyment will end and the stress will come. So we need to turn toward Krishna. But sometimes some people are so materially obsessed that they just don't think about spiritual life. So that's what happens to Puranjan. And it's described now that Puranjan dies and then he is reborn. Now all along his avigyat sakha, his friend is there with him, but Puranjan pays no attention to him. As he is being dragged away, Puranjan is only thinking about one person. Who is that?
Queen.
The queen. And because he is so obsessed, so attached to her, so what happens? In his next life, he becomes a woman. So whatever we remember at the time of death, that's what we'll attain. So because he's so attached to her, so he gets a female body. And then he becomes the queen Vaidarbhi, the wife of King Maladhwaja. Now in this case, the Maladhwaja is a very spiritually minded person, and they live together, and then he also grows old. And as he's aging, he decides to voluntarily end his life by yogic meditation. So he sits in yogic meditation and he absorbs himself in trance and he leaves his body. And in spiritual absorption, he departs. And at that time, his wife, she starts lamenting, "Oh, what has happened? My husband has died. How will I live? What will I do now?" And at that time, as she is lamenting beside her husband, then this avigyan sakha comes over there. And then he says to her that, avigyan sakha is unknown friend. Who is that? That is the super soul. And he says, "You don't know me, but I know you very well." He says, "We have been together for a long time, but you have neglected me. So I have been here for you. And now, when you are alone, I am there for you." And then he starts giving her spiritual wisdom. And when, as she starts hearing the spiritual wisdom, slowly she starts, her grief starts dissipating. She starts becoming calm. And as she starts becoming calm, this avigyan sakha, the super soul, starts giving more and more wisdom, more and more spiritual illumination. And by the guidance of that super soul, by that guidance of that avigyat sakha, eventually she becomes free from grief and she becomes enlightened. So now this is significant. In that life, she is lost, or he or she, whatever you want to say. Puranjan is no longer so materially, he's so materially infatuated that he just doesn't have any opportunity to move forward. But in the next life, what happens? Maladhwaja is a virtuous king. He is spiritually minded. That association affects Puranjan also. So see, everybody faces grief in life. Life has many distresses for everyone. Now when those distresses come, if there is some spiritual association around us, then we become spiritually receptive. If there is no spiritual association around us, then distresses simply make us frustrated. They make us resentful. They make us hopeless. Or they can make us very angry. Why? Life is so terrible. Basically, distress can make us destructive. Sometimes the destructive is towards ourselves. What is the point of my life? What is the point of living? That's what makes people suicidal. Or distress can make us destructive externally. Now, if I am not happy, what right does anyone else have to be happy? So this is the kind of reaction that comes when distress is there. But if amid distress somebody has spiritual association, that makes them spiritually receptive. And when the spiritual receptivity is there, then that person turns toward the super soul. The super soul is always there, but the super soul is very rarely perceivable. So, but through spiritual association, just by being in that association, our receptivity to the super soul increases. So in this second life, so it's like what has happened in the story is that the story, in the first part, there is an elaborately built metaphor. Now, in the second part of the story, the metaphor is not going on that elaborately. Because what is happening in the second part? The general principles of transmigration and spiritual elevation are being depicted over here. So that's why the name is also not Puranjan. The name is also not Puranjani. The name is also changed. So what is happening in the next life, in the story in the next life, whenever we use a metaphor, the metaphor has a particular context and a particular purpose. There is something called stretching a metaphor. Every metaphor is like a rubber band. If something is heavy, we put a rubber band around it. It's held in place. And then say if we have a big cloth bag, we put a rubber band and it gets tightly folded, and we can just pick the rubber band and we can hold it. So a rubber band gives a sort of finiteness and accessibility to something which might be shapeless or very big. But if you stretch the rubber band too much, the rubber band breaks. So similarly, every metaphor is like a rubber band. A metaphor helps us to get hold of something which is very big, something which is not that easily accessible. But if you stretch the metaphor, then the metaphor starts breaking. And that's why different metaphors are used for different purposes. Say for example, if you consider the basic metaphor of the soul and the body, the car body animal, but that car is like the body, the soul is like the
driver.
Now in that metaphor, the soul is said to be the driver. But if you consider the chariot body metaphor, in that who is the driver?
Mind.
The mind?
The soul.
Wait a minute. That's the chariot. What is the chariot? Is the body. Who are the horses?
Senses.
What are the reins that hold the horses?
Mind.
Who is the charioteer?
Intelligence.
And who is the warrior is who? The warrior or the passenger is the soul. So in this case, it's the soul is not the driver. The soul is more like the passenger. Driven by the charioteer. So what is happening over here? So the first metaphor is this purpose is to the car body metaphor. Its purpose is simply one, that the animating spirit, the energy, the activation, the life does not come from matter. It comes from something beyond the matter. But the chariot body metaphor, its purpose is something else. Its purpose is to illustrate the mechanism by which this whole thing works. And that's why we have the subtle body and the mind and the intelligence coming in. So the soul's position has shifted from the driver to the passenger. Now you can go further, and Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita that actually it is Krishna who causes the wandering of all living beings. Ishvara sarva bhutanam hriddeshe arjuna tishtati brahmayan sarva bhutani yantra rudhani mayaya. What this means is that actually it is the soul cannot influence matter at all. It is the soul has a desire, and the super soul influences matter. Super soul is in control of matter. We are not in control of matter. So now if you want to talk about how God is in charge, then we will take another metaphor. This metaphor is that actually, say when I am speaking right now. So I just desire to speak something. I have a thought and I start speaking. So for me, it might appear very straightforward how I speak. But actually, it's not that straightforward. Why? Because if I try to analyze how my voice box moves, what kind of the tracheal nerves and every tracheal organs, how it all moves to produce a particular sound, it's extremely complicated. I don't even know how it happens. So all that I know is that I desire to speak, and then all the voice muscles start moving accordingly. So who is doing it? It is, I am not doing it. It is the super soul doing it. So Prabhupada says, we may desire to raise our hand and our hand may rise. But if you get paralysis, I desire to raise my hand and it doesn't rise. So it is I desire, the super soul sanctions and then the body executes. The super soul is in between. So in that case, it is like everything that we are doing. Say, suppose in the past the computers were very complex, And if somebody wanted to operate a computer, they would tell the operator, do this, do this, do this. So I tell and the operator does it all. So it's like that we are not the direct controllers. So basically the point is each metaphor has a purpose. So the first part of the story is to develop the metaphor. And the metaphor is centered and restricted to the first part. And the second part, it's transmigratory principle that I illustrated. So the transmigratory principle means how the soul goes from one body to another and what happens. So in this case, basically there is association externally and there is association internally. So the external association of Malayadvaja makes either be more receptive to the internal association of the super soul. So in that sense, the spiritual consciousness that is there within all of us, it's like a candle. Within the candle, the potential to be lit is there. But unless the candle comes in contact with another candle, another lit object, the candle cannot light. So similarly, the spiritual potential within us, it has to awaken somehow. And that awakens by spiritual association. So for all of us, our mind often gives us a certain set of options. And initially, Krishna consciousness has to fit within the mindset of options. That means, why do sometimes people go to a temple? Or why do people come to satsang? Because based on their culture, their upbringing, this is something which is good to do. Let's do it. So initially, even the spiritual, because we cannot perceive anything beyond the mind. So even the spiritual has to come within the framework of the mind. But when it comes over there initially, what happens by that? Oh, this is good. Let's do this. Suppose in the spiritual life, if something we just don't like at all, it's very, very difficult to do it for a long time. The mind will just not allow us to do it. But if there's something which we like, yeah, I can do this. I like to do this. And by that, gradually, what happens? Initially, something within the framework of the mind is what we start with. And that is how we all have to like something in bhakti. That's how we'll continue it. And Prabhupada, then he talks about how Shraddha, faith is needed for the spiritual journey. But Prabhupada translates Shraddha simply as favorable curiosity. That, oh, these people seem to be doing something interesting, let's check it out. So that within what interests the mind, something we find within bhakti that starts off our spiritual journey. And then gradually, if you keep doing more and more, slowly the mind's control on us starts decreasing. So Krishna enters into the mind, and as Krishna enters into the mind, what happens? Krishna starts attracting us more and more. So how bhakti works is, Krishna comes first as an option within the mind, and then Krishna becomes an option to the mind. That means, initially, we practice bhakti because, oh, this is nice, I like it. But afterwards, Krishna becomes an option to the mind. That means, even if my mind doesn't like it, still I'll do it. So we become a little more free from the control of the mind as we keep practicing bhakti. And then, as Krishna becomes an option to the mind, and we choose, the mind is saying this, okay, Krishna is saying this, what should I do? Those are like choice points. See, if you are going on an expressway, even if you realize you have taken a wrong turn, I think here you call it motorway, isn't it? Okay. So if you are going on a motorway, sometimes if you have taken a wrong turn, you cannot immediately change the turn. Like the whole momentum is going in a particular way, there are particular exit points. There you can go out. So like that for us, when the mind takes control of us, quite often there are times when we just get pushed along. We can't do much about it. But there are choice points. Just like on expressway, up to a particular point we have to go, but here the exit has come, now I'll go out. So like that, even when we are practicing sadhana bhakti, a large part of our life will be controlled by our mind. But there are certain choice points. Certain choice points means, for example, we all have our professional obligations, we have family obligations. And they will control a significant part of our life. And we have to do what we need to do. But there are choice points. Maybe sometimes we can go to temple, sometimes we can come for satsang, sometimes we can do our sadhana. And when we take these choice points, the more we take these choice points, the more the control of the mind starts decreasing. So initially, initially we see Krishna through the mind. Oh, I like Krishna, so I'll do it. But eventually, what happens? We see the mind through Krishna. Oh, this mind is saying this. Do I need to do this? What does Krishna say? Yeah, this is not bad. Yes, we can do it. But Krishna says, oh, this is not so good. Better minimize this. So actually, when Krishna comes closer to us than the mind, then we become spiritually safe. We become spiritually steady. That is called as Thayi Bhav. Steadily we start experiencing bhakti. Steadily we start experiencing peace and joy in the practice of bhakti. But till now, for most of us, we are in that journey. We are seeing Krishna through the mind. So Krishna is an option within the mind, and Krishna is also becoming an option to the mind for us. That means, yeah, my mind is saying this, but maybe I should do this. Maybe I should. Sometimes we do this, sometimes we do that. But gradually, as we keep choosing Krishna more and more, then Krishna comes closer and the mind starts going further. By saying the mind starts going further, what does it mean? That the mind's control on us decreases. The mind's proposals will still keep coming. Let's do this, let's do that. Just like Puranjan, when his wife got up, he got up. When the queen got up, he got up. When the queen sat down, he sat down. So like that, we are controlled by the mind, but the mind's proposals, we just accept without thinking initially. But afterward, we start thinking, we start evaluating. And then the mind is never rejected, because the mind is a part of the mechanism that the soul needs for functioning in the world. But if the mind is controlled, then the mind starts becoming our friend. That means when Krishna comes closer to us than the mind, see, if you look, I'll conclude with this point, that initially, if you see 6, 5, 6 and 7 in the Bhagavad Gita, 6, 5 says that, उद्धरेदात्मनात्मानं नात्मानं अवसादयेत् आत्मैव यात्मनो बन्धुर् आत्मैव रिपुरात्मनः. He says, elevate yourself with the mind, don't degrade yourself with the mind. The mind can be your friend and the mind can be your enemy. What this means is that if you consider the mind to be like a movie screen, which is showing us the whole world. So on the movies, on television, on the internet, there can be some educative things, there can be something which can illuminate us also, there can be something can degrade us. So what Krishna is saying, whatever the mind shows you, you cannot have unlimited freedom, you cannot reject the mind, but in what the mind is showing you, choose that which will elevate you and don't choose that which will degrade you. Then the next verse he says is, Bandhuratmatmanastasya yenatmaivatmana jita anatmanasu shatrutve vartetatmaiva shatruvat. Says, if you can control the mind is your friend. If the mind controls you, it is your enemy. What this means is that the mind has various options. If the mind determines your choices, that means the mind controls you, then you will be dragged down. But if you control the mind, you choose, you make the choices, then the mind can be your friend, because the mind can give us good choices also. And the next verse is significant. What it says? Jitatmana prashantasya paramatma samahitaha shitoshna sukha dukkheshu tatha mana apamanayo. That for one, if you control the mind, jitatmana prashantasya, the mind become peaceful, then the super soul is already reached. Paramatma samahitaha. That means the super soul has come closer to us than the mind. That means we use the super soul's version, or rather super soul, the knowledge from the super soul to process the mind. And then what happens? When the super soul is, we are close to the super soul, then the world's dualities don't trouble us so much. Krishna talks about three dualities: physical, mental and egoistic, at the level of the ego. Shitoshna sukha dukkha manapaman. So heat, cold, like maybe some of you may feel a little cold now. It's a physical duality. Then sometimes some things feel pleasant, some things feel unpleasant, that is mental duality. And beyond it is the duality at the level of ego, honor, dishonor. Now, when Krishna repeatedly says that don't be affected by these dualities, Now, what does it mean? Is it that we are meant to be like stoic, emotionless, and don't be affected by any dualities? No, the point is that don't let the dualities determine your actions, determine your decisions. It's like when this happens, I said that this is a illustration for the concluding point that once the Krishna comes closer to us in the mind, then our spiritual life becomes steady. So what it means is that, say, suppose we are on a journey, and on that journey, at the end, maybe we have a relative has passed away or relative is going to pass away, and they want to give us a big inheritance, maybe $5 million or £5 million. And then we are going along the road, and on the side of the road, we see a £5 note over there. And you think, oh, this £5, let me get this. And as soon as we move toward the £5 note, it starts flying away. And then we go after it, and it flies further away. And it flies further away. And what happens? Instead of going on the road toward the £5 million, we seek the £5 and we lose the £5 million. Or in contrast, so the promise of the £5. Or say we have a £5 note already in our pocket. And some thug comes and grabs that £5 note and starts running away. How dare you steal from me? We start running after that person. And again, when running from that after that person, what happens? We lose the chance to get the £5 million. So when Krishna is saying, don't be affected by dualities, what he means is that stay focused in your spiritual purpose. This point is later illustrated early in 520 when he says that dukkheshvanu dignaman, no, na prahrishet priyam prapya no dvijet prapya cha priyam sthira buddhir asammoodho brahma vid brahmani sthitaha. Brahmani sthitaha, become spiritually situated. So when we start, what happens for us right now, Krishna consciousness is good, but we don't think of it as $5 million. We think of this $5 to be $5 million. And if this is getting disturbed, I have to fix this right now at all costs. And Krishna consciousness, that's always there. Maybe I'll do it later. So right now, because the mind is too close to us, the mind overvalues the $5 and the mind devalues the $5 million. But as we start the mind starts getting disciplined, as Krishna starts coming closer to us, our evaluation system starts becoming more balanced. And that's how the dualities don't disturb us that much. Because we understand, if I'm pursuing Krishna, if I'm moving towards Krishna, then all these things, the ups and downs, they will come, they will go. If I can deal with them, I'll deal with them. If I can't, I'll tolerate them. But I won't get distracted from Krishna. So the test of a controlled mind is not that dualities don't come in a person's life, but dualities don't divert the person so much. They will affect us. Krishna doesn't say that be unfeeling and don't, if somebody dishonors you, you should not feel anything. Yes, you will perceive it as dishonor, but we won't get so affected by the dishonor that we will be so agitated that we will get diverted from the path of Krishna Bhakti. So that way, we can attain that sthayi bhava, we can steadily practice and ultimately attain Krishna. So I'll summarize. I spoke today based on the story of Puranjan, how we can manage our mind. So I started by speaking about how this is a metaphorical story in the Bhagavatam. And it begins with Puranjan asking two kinds of questions. You know, where did you come from and what are you doing over here? So the queen doesn't answer the questions about origin. I don't know where I came from, but if you want to enjoy, we are all here, we can all enjoy together. So like that, our material mind, material intelligence, it bypasses questions about origins and just focuses on, let's enjoy over here. And when he starts enjoying with her, it said that he just starts doing whatever she does. So like that, we just keep doing whatever the mind prompts us to do. And we don't feel that I'm controlled by the mind, because the mind gives us an illusion of freedom. It gives us options, but all the options the mind gives are materialistic only. So in that sense, we don't really have freedom. We just have the illusion of freedom. And as long as life seems to be comfortable, we often don't ask transcendental questions. So Puranjan keeps enjoying till Chandavegh attacks. And even he doesn't even notice the attack of the invader, because he seems to be enjoying. But as the attack starts penetrating, then it becomes alarming. So like his life starts going over. And then eventually he falls. So in between, he once just leaves his wife also and goes away for hunting. But then when he comes back, she's infuriated and he has to pacify her. So like that, sometimes we might not do what the mind says, but then the mind hits back and torments us and we have to go to a lot of trouble to pacify it. But eventually, he's killed and he's dragged from that body to another body. And there, he becomes a female, and then by the association of her spiritual husband and by the association of the Avigyan Sakha, the super soul, whom she has been neglecting for a long time. But now, the eyes open. So, what this means is that the metaphor is in the first part. In the second part, it's more the transmigratory principle being illustrated. So, here, because of spiritual association, gradually spiritual receptivity increases for her. And then she receives the super soul. Then, how this happens, I talk in terms of the mind's metaphor. If you consider that we are watching a movie through the mind, so initially Krishna has to come as an option within the options provided by the mind. So our mind is to like Krishna. So, and that is important, that association, in association we are presented bhakti in a way that is likable for our mind in some way. And then first Krishna comes as an option within the mind, and then gradually Krishna becomes an option to the mind. As we start liking Krishna bhakti more and more, then our attachment to Krishna increases, and even if the mind says no, okay, this is what the mind is saying, this is what Krishna is saying, what do I want to choose? And as we keep choosing Krishna more and more, then Krishna starts coming closer and the mind starts going further. That means whatever the mind says, it doesn't affect us so much. Rather than processing Krishna through the mind, we process the mind through Krishna. And that's when the dualities don't trouble us so much. Because we see the, initially the mind makes us think that honor, dishonor, this is the biggest thing in life. There's nothing more important. This is like $5 million. But as Krishna starts coming closer and closer to us, we start seeing that my connection with Krishna, my progress towards Krishna, that is the $5 million. And honor, dishonor, pleasure, pain, so like $5 losses, gains. Okay, if I can protect it, good. If I not, just let me move on. And that's how we become steady. And as we start progressing steadily in our bhakti, we start becoming more and more joyful. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Yes, Mataji.
I think the weather might change, so we can move inside because it might start raining, and then we can ask questions inside if that's okay with everyone. Yeah.
Shall we finish the question? Yeah.
Maybe we can wait for a few minutes. Let's wait for, if it rains, we'll go inside because we might finish also now. Yeah. Might not have many questions. Yeah. Okay, yes. An option to the mind.
Yeah. Now later on we listen, we choose Krishna more than any other thing that the mind is offering. So who is choosing and where is intelligence between mind and Krishna?
Okay. Intelligence doing that? Yeah. See, as I said, there are different metaphors which we can use for different purposes. So ultimately the chooser is the soul. It's like in the computer, there are many options coming and I am the user. Computer says, maybe your Facebook update has come up. Computer says, oh, your email has come up. WhatsApp has come up. What do you want to choose? Now in our computer, it doesn't get Veda base. Your time for reading spirituality has come up. That doesn't come as a notification usually. So basically, these are these various options. They are like coming through the software. And we are the chooser. The soul is the chooser. Soul is always the chooser. But in this metaphor, if you see broadly, the intelligence is not treated as a separate entity. Basically, just have the hardware, the software, and the user. So, like that, we have the body, the mind, and the soul. As I said earlier, it's more in terms of functionality. This difference between mind, intelligence, ego, it's more in terms of functionality. If you want to develop this metaphor further, we could say that the intelligence is like sometimes within the software itself, like if you want to organize your day. Mm-hmm. Or nowadays Gmail also has this, that you know, you can put some people as priority And then if you have got 50 males, then those people who are like important people, the priority males, they come at the top. And the other males will come at the bottom. Or if we are, say, we are looking at Google News, if it is at these four things are my interest, then what we are interested, that comes at the top. Whatever the interest comes at the bottom. Now, in what comes at the interest also, we may not read everything, we may choose. I want to read this, I don't want to read this. So basically, you could say that we could say that the intelligence is like the processor of the inputs coming from the mind. The intelligence is also part of the software. But like in the beginning also I said that whenever we go to a place, the place is so complicated that there are hundreds of inputs that can come in. But based on our purpose, we focus on those inputs that matter to us. So basically, similarly, the intelligence is like a, you broadly speaking, it's not exactly a selector. The selection is done by the soul. But the intelligence processes. Okay, this is more important. This is less important. Now, that what is more important, what is less important, that is based also on the nature of the intelligence. If somebody is, say, an alcoholic, then when they come to a room, the first thing they say, is there any bar over here? Are there any bottles over here? Now, that might not be actually important, but that's what it chooses. So, within the software, you could say there is one part which just brings in software and all the inputs and presents all the inputs. And there's another part which processes. So now, if this processor, if this processing is done properly, then that which is really important for us will come on top. So that's why if the intelligence is spiritualized, then among the complex inputs that come in, like sometimes we give a class and some people just catch on to some irrelevant point. Why is this like this? Why is this like that? That's not the point. You know, focus on this point. But what happens? They just catch on to that some irrelevant point. So if the intelligence is properly guided, then among the many inputs that are coming in the mind, it will focus on that which is important. And then among those important, we can choose. So the intelligence is more like the filter or processor of what the mind is providing. Okay? Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, do we have two types of intelligence? No, it's one type of intelligence, but it's functions differently. So when it is spiritual, it is more directed toward Krishna. When it is material, it is directed towards material things. That is by the, you could say, just the kind of input it is given. See, the intelligence, it's like children. They just love playing with toys. But the same child as he grows adult, he or she, they may start want to study, they value other things. What has happened? The intelligence has grown. Now, if you see, Krishna talks about smriti brahmashad buddhi nasho, buddhi nashat pranashyati. When memory is lost, then intelligence is lost, he says. That means intelligence is based on memory. Now, memory, now we can only remember something which we have learned earlier, isn't it? So, that means intelligence is founded in knowledge. So now what, in 1820 to 22 and 1830 to 32 in the Bhagavad Gita, 1820 to 22, Krishna talks about knowledge in the three modes. And 1830 to 32, he talks about intelligence in the three modes. And the difference between the two is interesting. He's talking about knowledge more in terms of jnanindriyas, taking in information from the world. Whereas buddhi, which is intelligence, he talks in terms of the karmendriyas, using the intelligence to act in the world. Using the knowledge to act in the world is the duty of the intelligence. So, basically, our knowledge changes, our intelligence changes based on our knowledge and our recollection of that knowledge, our memory. Okay, thank you. Yes, Prabhu. Do we need to go inside?
I think we do.
Yeah, I think we'll go inside.
We take all this. Yeah, we can just be on the side. Yeah, thank you. This chair we can leave outside. I'll put it near the window so we can just.
Oh God.